Well, listen, we're delighted you're back. Celebrate is, I think, a great representation of your work. And we've got a load of Absolute Radio listeners here now. I want to ask you a question or two. So we'll fire away. And it's Roy, who's sitting right by me. So, afternoon. Roy Serridge.
Hi, afternoon. Hopefully there's not a clash of accents here. I've just wondered if there was ever a feeling of a Rolling Stones versus Beatles-like competition between yourselves and other bands such as U2 and Echo and the Bunnymen in the early 80s. Or did you find that you drove each other's on to make better records and better, you know, sort of better albums and stuff?
Well, I suppose when you begin, there's always that. But if you didn't have that feeling, I think, you know, it would be sort of something we'd be missing. Because, you know, when you're younger, you're always competitive, you know. But no, you know, in particular with you two, we were great friends at a very early stage. You know, their first album, we met them and quickly became really great friends. And I think in relation to you two, for example, we would see each other every year, you know, and we would go to, you know, we would sort of, like, you know, hang out together, and, you know, so that was always a really healthy thing. We always, like, really enjoyed the kind of journey we were both on. You know, we were very different, really, you know, but in many ways very similar, but not, I wouldn't say musically, but very similar in nearly every other aspect, you know, Celts, you know, particular, you know, view on whatever, you know, and you know, again, we were lucky in the 80s, you know, we got to meet all these bands, you know, good friends with the Bunnymen, you know, and we'd meet them in Australia, you know, and, you know, when you're younger like that, it's incredible to have that sort of a, you know.
I think what you said there is true, that we actually encouraged each other, because Charlie said we would go and see them, we would buy the records as well, and you know, it definitely inspired you. You know, I think to make music, you have to be a music fan. And I think the other thing in common, once having met them, the interesting thing would be that we were all of a similar age, and had you gone through our record collections, we were probably all influenced by the same stuff, and so lots in common. But in terms of the competition, when you put out a record, you were really competing with everyone in the chart that week, and but at the end of the day, Wham was better than any of us. Let's be honest.
Yeah, Roy, great question. Thank you for getting this underway. I've got one here, guys, from Dan Millard, who couldn't be with us today, and he said the plight of Nelson Mandela and the South African political situation in the 80s inspired a number of tracks on arguably, in Dan's opinion, one of your finest pieces of work, and I think a lot of people would agree with that, the album Street Fighting Years. If you were to write a track in 2013 reflecting on Mandela, or indeed the events since Nelson Mandela's release in 1990, what would it be called, and what would be the message of the song?
I mean, I think the fact that we haven't probably suggests that we feel we've been there and done that. I mean, the Mandela song and song like Belfast Child and such, although the issues behind those songs, Mandela obviously is free and has been for a long time, apartheid has ended, Belfast has moved a long, long way progressively from when we wrote those songs, but the actual issues themselves, racism and war and all that stuff, they just change geography. But the songs can still live on, and in fact, they do. You know, we still sometimes play them, and they are still relevant. I don't think we could do a better job now than we did of those. So I would think that's probably why. And also, the world has changed. It seemed back then that, you know, polarity was a lot more obvious. You know, there was Reagan and Thatcher and apartheid and anti-apartheid and East and West and the Berlin Wall and so on and so forth. Now politics and such, it's so in the middle, and actually your politics now can be anything from what coffee you drink to what jeans you wear or where you go on holiday or how you go on holiday. It's changed, and I think, well, to recap, I think we've been there and done it.
Yeah. Charlie, anything to add, or should we move on?
Actually, no. I mean, I think Jim.
Okay. Yeah. Absolutely brilliant answer. Paul Harris has a question about your career. Hello, Paul.
Hello. Good afternoon, guys. Can I just start by saying it's great to see you back on tour, still making records. I mean, it's really good. You know, has such a long career. I followed you since the late 70s, early 80s. And with such a long and illustrious career, can you sort of just touch on what you think are your career-defining moments? What are those things that stick in your mind as being real landmarks and milestones for you?
Meeting Charlie. genuinely, for me.
Yeah, absolutely.
He might not feel the same.
No, I must say.
I guess it's the start of the songwriting part.
It's a genesis, that's what it came from. But
I mean, for me, I particularly remember when we had our first Promise You a Miracle, which was the first real chart hit that we had. And somehow, yeah, I mean, we never ever experienced the feeling of, oh, suddenly we've made it, you know, because it was so gradual, you know. But that moment for me was like, oh, okay, we can go on now. Because we had, like, you know, quite a lot of ups and downs before that, and moments where it could have went off the rails completely, you know, but we get through that, and at that point it was a bit like, okay, we're on, you know, we're going to go with this now, full scale, you know. It was a great defining moment for me.
I guess the fans as well, when New Gold Dream came out, it really did start to go, I guess, interstellar for you pretty much, you know, for the rest of the 80s.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's true. That was the record that sort of brought the cult thing and the mainstream success. I mean, others might say, don't you forget about me, because it then was a whole different stratosphere and took us onto MTV and all that stuff. Remember MTV? But you know, our first gigs, you know, they're landmarks. And although it was quite right to mention Live Aid and the Mandela concerts, and these are the iconic concerts, but in a funny way, you know, in those first 4 or 5 years, we'd go to Holland, we'd go to Germany, we'd be playing these back road gigs. As I keep saying, there'd be two men and a dog there, but by the end of the gig, the two men and a dog would be going nuts, and we would sort of think, this is happening. No one else would believe it, and certainly the sales weren't there to back it up, but we were learning our trade, and I think, although they weren't, you know, career-defining moments, they were, you know, that was the very oxygen that we needed to breathe then.
Thank you.
Would you say New Gold Dream is your seminal album, as far as the fans are concerned? I mean,
I think, yeah.
What about for you? What would your one be, if you could pick one, both of you?
I like the one previous, Sons and Fascination. But I think, although we're maybe a bit too adventurous and not quite able to pull off what we wanted, but I think the imagination in the band then was really something, and the ambition and so New Gold Dream just sort of fell together, you know. It was probably not right to say effortless, but there was a lot of, it just seemed everything we were trying was working, and that the moment, it was the right moment, the right time.
We've got a question from Neil Yates here about songs.
I just wanted to know what your favourite three Simple Minds songs were that you've ever written. Jim first, and then Charlie.
God, usually people ask you one, and that's hard enough to, but three, I mean, bear in mind, Neil, that it'll change from week to week, but I think Hypnotize is a great song. I think that's a really great song. It's not one of the, it's fairly well known, but not one of the most well known. It's one of Charlie's. Obviously, thinking of playing live, a song like Waterfront always does it, but from the album I was talking about there, Sons and Fascination, I'm talking myself out of a job, the instrumental. The instrumental. Don't do many more of them, please. That's been an amazing tune because it's been sampled so many times and you know, before anyone had heard of ambient music and house music and all that, guys were already doing it. So, you know, well, there are a few that spring to mind.
Charlie?
For me, I think Someone Somewhere in Summertime, I love as a track. And The American, funny enough, because I have such a great memory of how that was recorded. And at that point, I think also, like Jim had said there, you know, Sons of Fascination for me is probably one of my favourite albums that we've done. Not that I think about it, like, you know, that much, but just the, you know, that track was a really, really great. It was a fantastic. It was done really fast, and just everything had a sort of real attitude to it. It was really, you know, it was kind of good creative moment. And and Waterfront, because it's just, again, it was another one that sort of just came together, and it was as if it kind of wrote itself and recorded itself. In fact, we played with U2 in Phoenix Park in Dublin, and that was the first time we played the track before we'd recorded it even. And it was amazing. It just, it really, really was, you know, it was obvious that this would be a great track, you know.
Yeah. Great stuff. Maria Coles, you're next.
Hi. I'll just cut to the chase. If you had to pick a Simple Minds track to dedicate to each other, if you're in a situation where you had to do that, which one would you choose and why?
Oh, God. I don't think I've ever been asked that question. Depends how we're getting on.
Which one holds the most memories for you, and which, you know,
Well, you know, or maybe you don't know, for about 6 months before we were in this band, Charlie and I were in a band fairly infamously called Johnny and the Self Abusers. And we did, Johnny and the Self Abusers did one single, and they, in true punk fashion, split up the day the song was released, which probably did the world a favour. But the B-side of it, well, it was a double A-side, one called Dead Vandals, and I think it's the first song that Charlie and I wrote together, or certainly the first song that we wrote and recorded, and it's rubbish, but but I love it, you know, because I still recall us, you know, sitting there working it out, and even in the sort of recording, you can feel there's an intensity about it that we were. It was early days, but we meant business, and so I would choose that one.
Well, actually, for me, funny enough, it would be Someone Somewhere in Summertime, because the thing is that. It sort of, you know, I mean, I remember when we were writing that, there was actually, you know, we just would jam, and, you know, out of like about 10 hours of just rubbish, really, Jim as always, which is really kind of like, you know, encapsulates the way that we usually get ideas and end up developing them. Jim had just picked out like, you know, a fraction of a second of just something. And said, that's amazing, you know. To dig through that stuff is an immense thing to get, you know, because I mean, you need to be able to sort of hear it in a way, you know. And I think that's the way we, you know, that's the great luxury that we have is that quite often it could be a few chords that are the same, and you play them five or six times, and Jim will hear them different every time. And it's kind of like, and that song really in particular came about from like really just the tiniest little fragment. And to me, I always think our best stuff has been stuff that Jim's kind of spotted that we would never have seen, you know.
Good answer, eh? That was a good, great answer and a great question. Thank you. Karen Tully is next. Hi, Karen.
Hi, guys. I just want to know, how have you managed to remain friends, play together in a band and tour together for so long, especially when you live in different countries?
It is amazing. I mean, we, first of all, Charlie and I have been really lucky that we met each other and had this thing in common to meet music and to get the chance to have this kind of life. But it used to puzzle me in the early days, you know, that other people might not like it as much as we did. And I could never get my head around that, because I thought, what's there not to like about this, playing music and travelling and seeing the world and, you know, all this stuff. But it became apparent that not everyone was the same. You know, some people liked making music, but they didn't, after 10 years or whatever, the fragmented life that goes hand in hand, or the intense life that goes hand in hand, working with the same people in and out each other's pockets every day, it wasn't for everyone. But for Charlie and I, we seem to have had this kind of similar thing where it was for us, you know. And I think I think what amazes me is it's we spend long times together, and then we'll have months where we don't see each other and have very little contact. Then when we come together, not only is it obviously fresh, but it's amazing how whatever books he might have read, I'll have read, or whatever movies he will have seen, I will have seen, or whatever, which shows that we do have really a lot of similar tastes and interests. And exactly, so we have that, but we also know how to have a ruck. I mean, we can have a ruck and get over it very quickly, and that's important as well.
Just for the record, you live a lot in Italy, don't you?
Yeah.
Whereabouts are you, Charlie?
Well, I was living in Italy for a long time.
Right.
I've just left last year. Actually, I was in Rome for about 10 years.
All right.
I was there.
What happened?
Well, I was there most of the 80s. My girlfriend was from Rome in the 80s.
Okay.
I used to be there. And I moved back there. And then at the moment, I'm kind of homeless.
No, are you?
Kind of welcome
to stay here.
It's not a bad
thing. Well, there's a few spare bedrooms here, I think. You'll be all right. What about Mel? Where's he based?
He's London.
He's in London.
Is
yeah,
he?
Yeah,
yeah,
he's in London. Yeah. Very much a London boy. And Sarah Brown, who sings with us, London. It's a good mix.
Yeah, the other guys are all Glasgow, so.
Really?
Yeah.
All the rest are in Glasgow. Oh, yes. Martin Reid. Hi, Martin.
Good afternoon, Jim. Good afternoon, Charlie. Nice to have the opportunity to meet you both.
Thank you.
Fantastic to see you back on the road. My wife, Jackie, who's here, saw you in Brighton a few weeks ago. Absolutely brilliant gig. Fantastic.
Thank you.
Like a party. We went home thinking we'd been to a party. It was brilliant.
You can't get a better compliment than that.
My question to you is, in all the years and live gigs that you've done anywhere in the world, what's the strangest thing ever been thrown on stage during the gig?
Don't know if you're allowed to say it on radio.
Try.
Pig's head.
Really?
You can say that on radio. Yeah, that was one of the early Glasgow punk ones. Yeah. that's pretty horrific. I don't know if we can top that, but yeah, various bits of underclothing. That was us throwing at each other.
I mean, you were going to say false arm holding a can of Tennent.
Well, there could be that. Sometimes it's funny, you go to places and flags get thrown on stage, and in the heat of the moment, you know, you're just tempted to pick it up and wave it around, and then it can be some dodgy flag or some dodgy political party or whatever. Things like that. But in general, no. I think the pig's head was early, and I don't think we've topped that. Being vegetarians, it wasn't quite appreciated.
Charlie, have you had anything
lobbed at you? Well, no, I mean, the obvious ones. We played in Japan years ago in the 80s, and it was one of these, you play at like 5 o'clock in the afternoon. It's very strange. And it was just like the stage was just covered with it. Like, you know, gifts, because I mean, they're really, you know, they throw gifts at you, and it was like
sort of bonsai trees.
And we couldn't play for roadies cleaning up, you know. They were like, they had sackfuls of stuff that they were disappearing with. But the other night there, we played in Liverpool, and our keyboard player at the end, I mean, of course, sometimes you just forget. Somebody threw a Liverpool scarf on, and he put it on, and like the whole crowd started booing. You know, and you're like, in Liverpool, you're like, but we're in Liverpool now. You're like, no, Everton, of course.
Tranmere Rovers fans. That's what they were. Joanna Bonner. Joanna, your question, please.
Hi, Jim. Hi, Charlie. In all your years of touring, you've had some excellent support bands, and I just wondered who have been some of your favourites.
Oh, we had a Polish band called Mislovich. I mean, I know, a Polish band, you know, it's like that. And they were really out there. I mean, it was the weirdest thing, because Somebody had sent me a link to a YouTube link to us in the 80s doing this track, a really obscure track in our third album called This Fear of Gods, and it was 23 minutes long. Right? This is when we were playing to, like, you know, two men and a dog. We were doing 23 minute versions, of course, and this band were supporting us. They couldn't speak a word of English, and they would play, like, you know, 18 minute tracks. It was amazing. It was, and they were really, really, they were great. They were, but very weird, and I loved them.
There was an American band called The Call, and they were great. You're right, we've had some fantastic bands, and there's nothing better when you've got a band on, you know, before you, that's already got the audience up and into it. And over the last few years, OMD were great. I mean, they did, like, you know, 15 songs, everyone was a hit. Not really a support band, but they were on the bill with us. This year, later on, when we come through, we've got Ultravox. It's always, you know, which I think, you know, we will want to watch the bands. Deacon Blue were fantastic. But there's been, yeah, we've had Lou Reed once played with us in Madrid, and I mean, we grew up with Lou Reed, and to have him open was really something. But we have had to follow some people as well at festivals. Sometimes you got to follow. So I remember one time we were playing in Croatia, and it was one of these, I hate the late gigs, you know, as you get older and stuff. You're like, midnight, Jesus. I go to bed at 9 when I'm home, you know. So, and we were driving somewhere. It was the middle of some forest and raining. I just wasn't into it at all. You know, I knew I'd had to get myself into it. And as we arrived, it was something like Mad Max. We went through this forest, and there was a clearing, and there was this, you know, civilization. And I said, there was this horrendous noise. I mean, it was like a banshee wailing, and the place was going mental. I thought, how are we going to... I said, who's on? They went, Iggy Pop. And you got to follow Iggy Pop. I mean, there's a few people you don't want to follow. James Brown, Iggy Pop, Prince, to name but three, but Iggy Pop. And we got there, and the place was mayhem. And he was saying to everyone, go home after this, the thing's finished. He said, we thought, oh, thanks a lot, mate. But it was an honour to have them.
There was a great story. You know, Jim talking about the late festivals, and, you know, how much the, and it was a point, just like a really exasperated point, when the tour manager, Jim, had said, you know, what time are we going on tonight? And he said 12:30, and Jim was like, what is it with these gigs? I mean, like, you know what's going on? And they said, like, who am I, Dracula? And there was this silence, and the tour manager said, we're playing in Transylvania next week.
Why are we on at midnight? Am I Dracula? What's the midnight thing? Yeah. And the next gig was Transylvania.
David Moon. Dave, your question, please.
Thank you. I've been to a couple of gigs on the current tour, and they were fantastic. But what I'd like to know is, are there any Simple Minds songs that are particularly difficult to play and sing live, apart from Don't You Forget About Me, which we heard earlier on? If so, which ones?
I think we started doing Street Fighting Years, the song. That's quite a tricky one to get together. You know, it's like, it's got a lot of changes, but it's sort of, you know, dynamically, to get the dynamics right is really quite tricky. But it's, you know, we stopped playing it after about three shows.
But that was for different reasons.
Oh, the violin, that's better left than the cupboard, that one. I mean, Jim actually, you know.
I really made him.
Jim made me play that. Seriously, he did.
I begged him.
I mean, that's tough. I mean, I can't play violin. I really can't. I can't, you know. But
you fooled me. You fooled me.
I know. Well, no, I mean, that, you know, that particular part, I just sat and played it for hours and hours and hours to make sure I can play it, at least play that thing. It's terrible, it's really dreadful, but it's my attempt at being John Keel.
And to be fair to the guys, I mean, what I find really impressive is, before every tour, I mean, they rehearse for weeks on end, from first thing in the morning to last thing at night, and it must be really difficult, a lot of it, to pull off. But you know, we just finished touring in Australia before Christmas, and one would say, well, why are you rehearsing for weeks for a tour just a few months later? But they always want to get it better, and they are always looking to hone things and improve things or to find a different arrangement. And I would agree with your question. It must be difficult, but they make it look easy. You might have noticed the last 10 years I used these in-ears, and I wish I had done it much earlier. The in-ears have made life so much easier and so much enjoyable. In the old days, the monitoring, you know, it would be so hit or miss. One night would sound great, the next night, because of the venue, because of the, you know, we weren't really experienced either with the volumes, it could be, as I say, it was very hit or miss. But now with those in-ears, technically, it sounds so good, and I find that makes it a lot easier for me to work. Other than that, I just don't. We do average 5 gigs a week, and November 1 week 6 gigs a week, and we do between 2 and 2.5 hours a night. One of the good things about no drinking isn't I don't drink, which means I'm not up all night sitting, yapping away, and that's made things easier as well. Touch wood.
Gail has got a question, I think, about new music. Hi, Gail.
I just wanted to say I love the new single, and I think it compares with any of your hits from the 80s. I just wondered, has your writing process changed over the years, and where do you get your inspiration from lyrically?
I mean, one of the problems I think that Jim and I found is that, like, you know, like the question earlier on about, like, how we, you know, have managed to stay friends for so long. One of the things, if you could call it a problem, is that we think so alike that sometimes you need objectivity that we wouldn't have, because, you know, we're thinking exactly the same. And, you know, we've worked with a lot of different people in the writing process now, and that's kind of gave us a real other sort of angle, you know, that would have been closed before. And again, like, you know, you're forced to sort of be in outside of your comfort zone in a really great way, you know. And you really need that sort of challenge. And I would say that's the... When Mick wasn't in the band anymore, it was really like we had to really readjust again, because, you know, Mick was a big part of the creative process in that earlier period. And after that, Jim and I, we sort of like, you know, we could still manage to sort of like, you know, make albums, and, you know, but again, like, you know, we were so similar that we really needed another angle, and we've had that from quite a few people, you know. And in fact, a track I love, this track Stay Visible, was written by a guy, Jez Code, who co-produced our last two albums, and that was Jez's song, really, you know. I mean, it sounds like a Simple Minds track to me, which is fantastic, you know, but I mean, it was entirely Jez's thing, you know. So it's really been a great element to bring in.
I think essentially we still work the same way as we did in the early days. You know, where Charlie will come up with an idea. Sometimes it's all there. Other times it's maybe a seed of an idea or whatever, and I'll get excited about it. That's kind of how it was like that in the very early days as well. But one of the things, the geography's changed. Earlier this year, after we were in Australia, you know, sort of sneakily stayed on and went to Bali. And there was one day where I'd arranged this trip to get up and do a hike up a volcano thing, but I was looking for an excuse to get out of it. And I got up, and Charlie had sent me an MP3 of a new idea that he'd just written, and I played it, and I got really excited, and the idea started flowing, and I thought, I can't do the volcano hike, I've got to work today. So I sat in this really beautiful garden and worked on Charlie's music, which makes it a wee bit different from some of the drafty basements that we used to work in the early days. But there you go, the technology, whatever you are in the world, you can work together and just send each other.
Okay, last question. Clive Johnson.
Hi, guys. Great to see you. Like Gail said, love Broken Glass Park. Absolutely fantastic track.
And what do you love about it?
I just thoroughly enjoy it. I just find it's very, you know, it's a very approachable song. And also enjoyed your gig in Bournemouth last week. Fantastic. But my question is, given that we've heard both Broken Glass Park and Blood Diamonds, does the forthcoming album have a title yet, or a working title?
It doesn't have a title that's been decided, but there's a few every day when I'm sort of looking through the lyrics that you think, oh, that could be one, or perhaps there's that. But we've still got a bit of work to do. In fact, when the current tour finishes in about 10 days' time, we go back to Ireland and we've got a few weeks pre-production for yet another batch of recording. But the answer, Clive, is no, there's not a title, but there's a few fancied ideas.
Can you elaborate?
No, probably no. But
Clive, it's going to be called From Basements to Barley.
From Basements to Barley.
You're not going to nick that, are you? Guys, thank you so much.
Thanks to everyone.
Sending in the questions. Yeah, exactly. And obviously, Jim and Charlie, a big thank you to you guys. You're always very accommodating. We loved you coming in to see us. Great fun spending time with you. They're going to be on Rock and Roll Football at the weekend talking about Celtic. So we've done that interview, but really great questions. I do believe... do you have time for a couple of photos? I think one or two would take some photos. Yeah. That's very kind of you. Yeah, so I'll let you get on with that. And thank you very much indeed for coming.
Thank you.